Strangely strange, but oddly normal.
Hi, my name's Jon Downes. I'm 50 years old today. Welcome to another edition of On the Track. Yes, it's true. On the 22nd of August this year, I celebrated my half century. And it's a very strange feeling to know that you've been on this planet for 50 years. Our friends Alan and Jenny from the Farmer's Arms made me a cake, and I almost burst into tears. I'm a soppy old sod, really. Earlier in the day, my darling wife Karina threw a tea party for me, the first proper birthday tea I've had since I was about 12 years old. Together with my housekeeper Helen, she even arranged a video present for me. At the weird weekend, she managed to get all my friends who weren't going to be with me for my birthday to wish me happy birthday on film, and that is something I'm always going to remember. Basically, I couldn't have asked for a better birthday, and I'm really grateful to everybody who made it possible. But my 50th wasn't the only thing of importance this month. Lots of other exciting things happened. We even got celebrity endorsements.
Hello, my name's Rad Scabies, and welcome to The Weird Weekend.
There really is nothing like The Weird Weekend anywhere else in the world. It's a most peculiar event, and it's something of which I'm very, very proud. Each year we start proceedings with a little piece of theatre featuring the children of the village. And each year we get a little bit more ambitious and a little bit more silly. For this year, for reasons known only to ourselves, we decided to adapt a piece of classic rock music, Sonic Attack, by Hawkman. And after having vowelised the lyrics and changed the rude bits, we handed it over to Miss Chloe Lott, aged 13, to do her own inimitable thing. I don't know about you, but she looks scary as hell to me.
Do not waste time blocking your ears. Do not waste time seeking a weird proof shelter. Try to get as close to the Weird Weekend as possible. Think only of yourselves.
Do not hide!
Think only of yourselves. Use your wheels, it is what they are for. Small babies may be placed inside special cocoons and should be left, if possible, in shelters. Do not attempt to use your own limbs. If no wheels are available, metal, not organic limbs should be employed whenever practical.
Do not hide!
In case of a Weird Weekend, survival means every man for himself. Statistically, more people get weird when they think of themselves. Always attempt to involve friends, relatives and loved ones. You have only a few seconds to escape. Use those seconds sensibly, or you will inevitably fail to become weird yourself.
Do not panic!
Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself. Do not panic. Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself. These are the first signs of a weird weekend. You will notice small objects such as ornaments oscillating. You will hear a distant hissing in your ears. You will feel dizzy. You will have difficulty focusing. You will need to breathe more rapidly. You may be subject to fits of hysterical shouting or even laughter.
Do not hide!
It's actually my favourite part of the Weird Weekend, and though I don't like to admit it to Dave, our technician, and my dear nephew, who always tells me that AV is the worst part of a technician's nightmare, I tell him, boy, it's my job as your uncle and as the person who employs the technician, even though I'm not paying you to give you nightmares, so get on with it. Dave, by the way, did a fantastic job this weird weekend. I don't know what I'd have done without him. He is a marvellous young man, and I lean on him more and more and more as the years go on.
Think only of yourself. Do not panic. Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself.
Think only of yourself.
Signs of an imminent weird weekend. Your only protection is flight. If you are less than 10 years old, remain in your shelter and use your cocoon. Remember, you can help no one else.
Do not panic!
You can help no one else. You can help no one else. Do not panic. Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself.
Think only of yourself.
Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself. Do not panic. Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself.
Think only of yourself.
Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself. Do not panic. Think only of yourself. Think only of yourself.
Think only of yourself.
Do not panic.
Think only of yourself.
Do not panic.
Think only of yourself.
And it always ends up with Elizabeth Harding, one of the young ladies of the village, welcoming everyone to the weird weekend.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, on behalf of the Centre for Fortean Zoology, on behalf of the people of the village, on behalf of the international cryptozoological community, welcome to Wolsey, and I hope you have a very weird weekend.
And I think this funny little morality tale, the moral of which really is if you see aliens trying to abduct you, don't run away because they're probably going to be trying to give you space cake, sets the tone for the weird weekend, because the weird weekend isn't just about cryptozoology. It's about half-assed surrealism, silliness, friendship, psychedelic music, jollity and all sorts of other fun things. It is, as I've always said, a place for seeing old friends and meeting new ones. And it's a place where new alliances and working relationships are often forged. It is undoubtedly the weirdest weekend of the year, and for many years it's been my favourite. I'm not going to pretend that I enjoyed this one very much, but that was because of circumstances beyond anyone's control, and plans are already underway for next year's, which is going to be bigger and better than ever.
Did you see the movie that we showed this morning? You didn't? Okay. So you might be aware that there was a long time ago, Gigantopithecus.
Something that I feel is very important about the Weird Weekend is that we lay on stuff for kids, not just face painting and model making, important though that is, but lectures like this one by Paul Veller, who told an audience of enraptured village children about Bigfoot. The Weird Weekend is also the time when we celebrate the efforts of those who have worked so hard to help the CFZ during the previous year, and we reward their efforts with a plastic baboon painted gold.
And there's one last one. About 4 months ago, I got contacted by a very shy young lady who was the supporter of Mr. Downes. I wrote back and said, I don't know Mr. Downes. He died in February 2006. Nobody's ever called me anything but John. And it turned out that she was not just a very talented author who's written an absolutely bloody fantastic book that I urge you all to go out and buy, but she is the best sub-editor I've ever worked with. She has overcome a lot of her own health problems to come and be here and to come and work daily on the blog. I don't know how I would do without her. She is an incredibly valued member of the team. And both Karina and I are getting increasingly fond of her because she's a very, very special person. Lizzie, come on down here. Try not to fall down the steps while you do it.
Award winners this year were Max Blake, who needs no introduction to people who watch on the track, Glenn Vaudry, a stalwart of the Bloggo and a new CFZ author, Stuart Garner, who at the last minute, after Dave Curtis had to pull out, stepped in and did the children's area for us, Gavin Lloyd Wilson, the news editor of the blog, and the incomparable Lizzie Clancy.
It's Chris Clark. Chris, can you come up here a minute? Okay. We've got Dave Archer in here. Dave, come on down.
The price is right.
Right, this is the official announcement of the CFZ Expedition 2009. Now, usually I speak at the unconvention. Yeah, I speak at the unconvention. Usually I speak at the Weird Weekend, and my talk is about this year's monster hunt. But this year we haven't done a monster hunt yet because it's not till September. The new CFZ expedition is happening in September for 2 weeks, and I actually feel a bit churlish about calling it the CFZ expedition, even though we're all CFZ members. The man who initiated this, whose baby it is, whose idea it was, is a very good friend of mine called Adam Davis, who can't be here today. He's another cryptozoologist, a smashing guy, and he suggested this expedition, and he really set it up, and then invited myself and Chris and Dave along on it. So he's the head of this expedition, not me. I'm along as experienced cryptozoologist. Chris and Dave are also along. Chris has come on every expedition I've ever been on, bar one, and an expedition wouldn't be the same without Chris. Dave's a relative new boy. He came to Russia with us last year, but he did amazingly. He got up mountains that beat the rest of us, death-defyingly, and dug at the top of them. Even though he didn't find any Elmaster corpses, he went there. So, the new expedition. They say that three's the charm, so we're going back for a third crack at the Orang Pendek in Sumatra. Now, before, we've concentrated on Gunung Tuju, the Lake of Seven Peaks. This time, we're in the lowland jungles with the Kaboo people, where there have been an awful lot of sightings of the Orang Pendek, and the Kaboo are a very primitive race of tribesmen who live in Sumatra. They were there long before the other Sumatrans who came down from Malaya. They look physically completely different. We've met them before, briefly. They speak a completely different language, but there's been a hell of a lot of Orang Pendek sightings around the lowland jungles with the Kaboo people. And also, dreadfully so.
You'll fit in well.
Thank you. I'm an absolute brute. You can see my eyebrows join in the middle. Also in the same area, there are sightings of immensely large snakes, which are said to have horns. The last time we were there, we talked to the chief of the Kaboo, Nylan, and he told us that not only he'd seen an Orang Pendek, but he'd seen immensely big snakes. There were stories of a 50-foot python that had been captured in the area. It was supposed to have been worshipped as a god by the Kaboo, but a man from Java convinced them to stop worshipping it and capture it for his zoo in Jakarta. His zoo in Jakarta. So, we went and asked the Kaboo about that. We went and asked the Kaboo, and the Kaboo said, no, this is nonsense.
Other one.
Hello? Me and machines, I hate them. It's gone again, what's the one? I can bang stones together, that's about it. The Kaboo said, no, we didn't catch a 50-foot python, and no, we don't worship them as gods. This python was 23 feet long, not 50 feet long, and we caught it and we sold it to this man. He called it fragrant flower and took it to his zoo in Jakarta where he feeds it on dogs, which is terrible. He should be feeding it on cats. Dogs are lovely, cats are revolting. But then I asked him, have you seen any huge snakes out in the jungle? And he said, yes, we've seen snakes 10 metres long. And he said, and they have horns like oxes. And he went on to tell me that he's seen these huge snakes that he calls nagas, that have horns on their heads. Now, there are horned snakes, but they're all very, very small, like the horned viper, the rhinoceros viper. And the horns, of course, are erectile scales on the head. So if this is on the level, we're dealing with a new species. So there could be two new species we're looking for in this area, the orang pendek and the giant horned snake. Guys, do you want to say anything?
It's my first expedition to Sumatra. Well, I'm looking forward to going pretty much. So. I wish we was going for 3 weeks, but we're only going for 2 weeks, unfortunately.
Yeah. Okay, and as always, Chris here is footing the lion's share of the bill for this. So I think this man who has supported the CFZ for years deserves a big, fat, juicy round of applause.
Now for something completely different.
I, Matthew Henry Christopher Osborne.
I, Matthew Henry Christopher Osborne.
Take you, Emma Jane Biddle.
Take you, Emma Jane Biddle.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
Until we are parted by death.
Until we are parted by death.
And this is my solemn vow.
And this is my solemn vow.
And now, Emma, this time go and hold Matthew's right hand and say nothing. I, Emma Jane Biddle. Take you, Matthew Henry Christopher Osborne.
Take you, Matthew Henry Christopher Osborne.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
Until we are parted by death. And this is my solemn vow. Mr. Tasman, do you have your ring?
Yes.
Bless them all. Pray a prayer of blessing on these rings. Eternal God, bless these rings, that they may be symbols of the love and trust between Matthew and Emma. Amen. Matthew, would you kindly put Emma's ring on her finger?
Would you give a big round of applause for Mr. and Mrs. Matthew Osborne?
Best to get you the shot of a lifetime. On the first weekend of August this year, Matthew Osborne, CFZ stalwart for the last 3 or 4 years, got married to his girlfriend Emma. Mr. and Mrs. Osborne, we wish you all the luck in the world. Welcome to the CFZ family, Emma.
And now for something completely different.
I bet you've never seen ones this big before. We have in this bag another bag containing some of the largest aquatic snails I've ever seen. Normally, pet stores might buy in snails like this. You might see them in stores called apple snails. And normally they buy them in, and within a couple of weeks they all die because A, no one wants them because no one cares, and B, they don't know how to look after them properly.
For some reason, most pet stores don't seem to know how to care for snails, so when they buy in bulk loads from a wholesaler, they don't seem to give them any appropriate food. And sometimes they put them alongside incompatible tagme, like loaches or cichlids, which will eat the snails alive very slowly. These spiny snails are Brotia pagodula, a rare species found only in one river in Myanmar. You know, the place that John's generation still call Burma. They've evolved the spines as a defence against predators, but they won't be needing them in this tank where they're being kept with yellow-bellied giardinas, even though this breaks the CFZ's code of not mixing biotopes. Many people fail with this species in captivity because they try and feed them on prepared food. They're best kept entirely on algae, but they are gorgeous, aren't they? These giant apple snails are probably a species called Pomacea haustrum, a fairly rare species in the trade found in Central and South America. Even though they're very large, these are actually not fully grown, and they could get up to another inch on top of their shell length. They're found in the same area as these Heterandaria formosa, so for once we're not mixing biotopes with snails. These look to be rescues. They've got very short antennae, which have obviously been eaten by something, and they're holding their shells very, very low to try and cover themselves from any biting. Hopefully in a couple of months they'll settle down, and they'll be out and about quite happily. Hopefully we can breed them, and then care for a new generation of magnificent mollusks.
It's been a remarkable month for peculiar crypto stories. I mean, have a look at this, and I don't mean 19-year-old Justina Folger messing around in her bikini. Towards the end of the clip, look at what happens in the woods on the far side of the river. It's supposed to be the second sighting in about a week of the Polish Yeti. The Polish Yeti, you may ask? Well, yes, as you probably know, there are hairy man-beast traditions in the folklore of most cultures, and Eastern Europe's no exception. Yes, there have been sightings on and off, but two in a week, both done on shaky camera phones, and both debuted on a Polish newspaper, which, amongst other newspaper exclusives that it has got on its website, is the world's most impressive chain of bras. Camera phones have a lot to answer for, as some members of the CFZ staff know to their cost. I'm not going to write off these stories just yet. I mean, this first piece of footage was supposedly taken by a bloke called Kowalski out in the wilds of eastern Poland. And let's face it, even yours truly had a sighting of something strange at Bolam Lake some years ago. But although I'm not dismissing the evidence out of hand, I see nothing in either of these two clips which couldn't be replicated by a bloke in a monkey suit. That is, apart from 19-year-old Miss Folger, but I think we'll leave that subject for the moment. But this was far from being the only strange crypto story to make the press during the month of August. For example, you want to see the Loch Ness Monster? Well, have a look at this. Go to Google Earth. Then type in these coordinates. And guess, what do you see? Is it the Loch Ness Monster? No, of course not. It's a boat with an interesting looking wake. But you'd be surprised how many people leapt on the Nessie bandwagon after seeing this picture. Proves it's now as queer as folk. And then there was this, the alien baby of Mexico, or according to Mexican newspapers, the being of Metepec. I love that title, it sounds like a Doctor Who fan novel from the early 1970s. However, according to many people, including Jaime Bosan, who I met in 1998 in Mexico City, and who seemed to be an eminently sensible and nice bloke, there are no signs of any earthly DNA on the body. Could that be because the body isn't made of flesh and blood and is actually made of plaster of Paris? Or could it be that you're looking for the wrong things, because it looks to me like a mummified marmoset or tamarind? Look, guys, get used to it. There ain't no such thing as aliens, or at least not flesh and blood, humaniform, carbon-based life form type aliens. We do live in an approximately infinite universe, and in the said approximately infinite universe, there must be an infinite number of habitable planets, but they are too far away for them to ever get here. And even if they did get here by mistake, why would they be leaving their offspring to be drowned by some Mexican peasant in a pool somewhere in rural Mexico? It ain't going to happen. Come on, guys, wise up. You don't have to make up fairy tales when we live in a universe, in a planet, for God's sake, that is so absolutely fantastic that every day, I for one, am just filled with wonder at the marvel of creation. But now I think it's time to go and have a look at this month's new and rediscovered species. A fish biologist in the Northwest Territories says that he may have found an entirely new species of cisco in Great Slave Lake. Paul Vesky of Golder Associates says that he and some federal government researchers were at the sub-islands near Yellowknife in October last year, pulling up nets when they hauled up the unusual-looking cisco with large fins, enormous eyes high up on its head and an upturned mouth. The male fish, 28 centimetres in length, has been named Corrigonus googly-eye, or the Google-eyed cisco. Scientists have discovered a striking new species of bald songbird in limestone regions of Southeast Asia. The bald-headed bird was spotted by scientists from the Wildlife Conservation Society in the University of Melbourne in Pha Lon, a limestone outcrop in central Laos. It is the first new species of bulbul to be discovered in 100 years, and it is the first bald songbird from mainland Asia. Goodness me. Researchers have discovered a new species of worm, which they have dubbed the green bomber. The worms, which live thousands of feet beneath the sea, can cast off green glowing body parts. In all, a total of 7 new species were discovered by a research team led by Karen Osborne of the Scripps Institute of Oceanography at the University of California. Researchers in the Canary Islands have found a number of new species on Lanzarote. During a cave diving expedition to explore the Tunnel de la Atlantida, the world's longest submarine lava tube on Lanzarote, an international team of scientists and cave divers have discovered a previously unknown species of crustacean belonging to the Remipede genus. They also discovered 2 new species of polychaete worm. The newly discovered species of Remipedia was named Spelonoctes Atlantida after the cave system in Pavitz. It's morphologically very similar to Spelonoctes onodidae, a remipede that has been known from the same lava tube since 1985.
Remipedes are a class of blind crustaceans that up until 1979 were only known from fossils. Then a species was discovered living in deep marine waters, followed by 17 more. It was then discovered they have a worldwide distribution in the neotropical zone. They're also interesting because they have a family called Godzillidae.
3 academics from the University of Canterbury have helped rediscover a seabird which was originally thought to have been driven to extinction by hungry European sailors in the late 18th century. The team have used an innovative multidisciplinary approach to resolve the taxonomic status of the so-called extinct Tasman booby, Sula Tasmani. It's the first study of its kind to report the rediscovery of an extinct bird using classical paleontological data combined with ancient and modern DNA data. Many rediscoveries of extinct birds are the result of an intensive search in the field, but ours is a little different. We rediscovered our bird in the laboratory, said Dr. Steves. What was once considered to be an extinct species, the Tasman booby, turns out to be a subspecies of a living species, the masked booby. And now these charismatic seabirds have a brand new name, Sula Dactylitra Tasmani. In what is bound to be sad news for everybody who has visited the CFZ over the past 2 years, this morning, just as we were putting the finishing touches to this episode of On the Track, our Chinese crested minnow, Rufus, was put to sleep. He had contracted a wasting disease and we could find no cure for him, and sadly he was euthanized this afternoon. Rest in peace, old buddy. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's about it for this episode. I'd like to say thank you to everybody who's helped, particularly with donations. This month I'd particularly like to thank Naomi and Richie over in Texas, Steve Jones, Lindsay Selby and Andy Roberts, who are amongst the many people who've donated. I'd also like to say thank you to my cameramen for this episode, who include Max Blake and Ol Lewis. I'd like to say thank you very much, as always, to my lovely wife Karina and to my two beautiful stepdaughters. Guys, the CFZ, I think, is a very valuable thing. We have a hell of a lot of good work to do. We are in the middle of the worst recession for many years, and we are struggling. But we will get through with your help. So if there's anything you feel you can do to contribute, financially, morally, or by donating money or work or goods or expertise, please get in touch, because the CFZ is a big family, and like every family, we need to stand together. So, until next time, seeing you.